How's it going, everybody? Bryan Alvarez here on Wrestling Observer Live. We are here every day, Monday through Friday, New Pacific 3 Eastern, Sunday, 3 Pacific 6 Eastern. It's Tuesday here on this program. You know what that means? We got a lot to get into here today on this lovely summer day. We finally got summer here, and I'm going to make the most of it. And as for this show, well, we'll do our best. Got a lot to get into here today, not the least of which is Ric Flair's final match. They announced it yesterday with an angle. It is, in fact, a tag team match. Ric Flair will be teaming with Andrade to face Jay Lethal and Jeff Jarrett. That's right. So Jeff Jarrett was a surprise announcement on both SmackDown and for Ric Flair's final match. So we'll tell you about that. We've also got the upcoming return of Kenny Omega. We can tell you a little bit more about that. Fightful reported it today. We've got the lineup for tonight's NXT. I guess it is tonight. AEW tomorrow. NXT 2.0 is tonight. And they are, in fact, doing that 20-woman Battle Royal. And they do, in fact, have 20 women. So we got the full lineup for that. We'll tell you about that. Full lineup for SummerSlam. Because, of course, Monday Night Raw was last night. And so we've got your weekly Raw report. Everybody's second favorite segment behind reviewing NXT 2.0. SmackDown on Friday and Rampage ratings as well. Ric Flair's foot injury and plenty more. If you'd like to join the show today, you know how to do it. 425-780-7566 is the phone number. That is 425-780-7566. Bryan at WrestlingObserver.com. At Bryan Alvarez on Twitter. Mike Sempervive will be joining us here soon. And we got a lot to get into, so stick around, everybody. Back in a moment, Wrestling Observer Live. Apparently, we weren't working for the old YouTubers a second ago. But Twitch, everything worked great on Twitch. That's why you should subscribe to the Twitch feed, twitch.tv/F4WVideo. Use your Amazon Prime account. Sign up free. You sign up free with Amazon Prime to our Twitch channel, and you get special things every now and then when we have pay-per-views. The pay-per-view post-show is live on Twitch for our subscribers, so you should check that out. And we got a lot to get into here today. Yesterday, we were talking about Ric Flair's final match. They did announce it at 6:05 Eastern. They did an angle where old Ric Flair was in the parking lot, and old Jay Lethal got awfully mad at him because he's been helping him get ready for this match. He's been training him, and he didn't even get a spot on the card. And Jay Lethal was so angry that he punched Ric Flair in his surgically repaired gut, which is what Flair screamed, by the way. My surgically repaired gut! I think it was those exact words, but it was something like that. And he goes down. And then up walks Jeff Jarrett and Karen Jarrett in all white. Probably see where this is going. And he goes to help Ric Flair. But then, you know, Ric Flair's, he doesn't really want this help. So Jeff Jarrett turns on Ric Flair. And he takes Karen's shoe and he busts open Ric, and Ric's bleeding all over the place and blood's all over Karen's dress. And the match is on. It is Ric Flair with plantar fasciitis in his foot, I might add, against Andrade with inflammation in his ankle. So we got a story here against Jeff Jarrett, the special referee at SummerSlam for the Street Profits match with the Usos. And his partner, Jay Lethal. So that's going to be Ric Flair's final match. And as noted yesterday, you'll be able to check it out. RicFlairsLastMatch.com has all the details. It's a big weekend. The roast of Ric Flair, Friday night, July 29th. Panels with Bryan Danielson, Claudio Castagnoli. Horseman reunion. Bret Hart's air talking SummerSlam 92. I just did a cameo the other day. Speaking of plugs, F4W Online on Cameo. And the guy was in the audience at SummerSlam 92. And that's like such a legendary show now that it was like I was doing a cameo for a celebrity. That guy was in the crowd, SummerSlam 92. Got Sunday panels with the former Page, Foley, Nash, the Hardys, part of StarCast 5. You can get tickets to Ric Flair's last match. Nashville Municipal Auditorium, $39. Tickets available at RicFlairsLastMatch.com. There's matches from NWA, MLW, AAA, Impact, New Japan, Ring of Honor, AEW. And I guess now WWE, since Jeff Jarrett is going to be part of the main event with Ric Flair. So check it out, fight.tv, pay-per-view on cable, satellite, RicFlairsLastMatch.com. You excited for this show, Mike? Are you worried?
That, my friends, was an ad. That's what that was. And I am actually a little bit excited because when you look at the undercard, that's a really good undercard. That is a really good, you know, whatever you want to say about Ric Flair having a last match. If you said, okay, well, here's a dream card taking place on the indies and you put together that show, that's pretty cool. So, you know, no complaints out of me when it comes to the lineup. When it comes to the match itself, I never needed to see Ric Flair back in the ring again. I had no interest in actually really seeing Ric Flair do anything at all. But if he is going to do something, he's got his son-in-law. He's got the guy who he trusts without a shadow of a doubt because he's been training him nonstop with Jay Lethal. And you have an unbelievable old professional in Jeff Jarrett who can do exactly what Ric Flair wants him to do. So, I mean, what can you really say? You know, we don't have to worry about Sting flying. You know, could Sting be there? Sure. But you don't have to worry about him flying off of something onto Ric Flair. You don't have to worry about any of this sort of stuff when it comes to the guys who are going to be in that match. So the best of luck to Flair because he's obviously banged up going into this thing. He's 77 with a pacemaker. But God bless him. And Dave said it, too, on the Wrestling Observer radio show. I'm a big fan of Jim Crockett Promotions and the history of it. And David Crockett never really got to have a goodbye. And when he got the trademark back for Jim Crockett Promotions, I mean, I can't do anything but celebrate that for him. So anything that takes place that helps the Crockett Foundation or helps him, I think that's a cool thing that's a part of this, too. As far as the match itself goes, yeah, I could have lived without it, but hey, it's another part of a big weekend.
In-ring return for Kenny Omega reportedly being targeted for All Out. Fightful reported the news Tuesday, following up on a Dave Meltzer note during a recent Observer Radio that a third meeting between FTR and the Young Bucks is being held off due to a major angle that is yet to begin. I think I told everybody that I would not be holding my breath for the Young Bucks to win the tag titles back to do that match with FTR, because I don't think it's going to happen. Tentative plans are that Omega would team with the Bucks in a trios match at the September pay-per-view. Opponents were not mentioned. Speculation it could be against Adam Cole and Red Dragon. Not independently confirmed the report as of this writing. Omega, who is rehabbing following several surgeries, told Fightful in a June interview his original return date was Forbidden Door. He didn't want to return too soon. Out of action since last November, Full Gear, when he lost the AEW world title to Hangman. Well, I have also heard that there are plans in the works for the return of Kenny Omega. Don't know what the plan is, but listen, I have no idea what the plan is, okay? But it says here that speculation is that he would team with the Young Bucks in a trios match, okay? Bro, that may very well be what's going on here, okay? It may. But maybe it's not, because, you know, they plant a lot of seeds, especially these Young Bucks, okay? And if you've been watching Being the Elite, they keep doing this this story where the Young Bucks want to call Hangman. They want to text Hangman. And they're always about to, but then they just can't send the text, okay? Well, I could not help but notice that on Wednesday, when the Dark Order showed up during that Hangman interview, Hangman had been on the phone. He was texting. And then he got all, oh, I better put my phone away. Well, who was he texting? Well, I don't think it's out of the possibility he was texting Kenny Omega. And you could do Kenny Omega and Hangman versus the Bucks. There's a lot of ways you could go with Kenny Omega, the Young Bucks, Hangman Page. They got a long-term storyline here. So, you know, there had also been talk that they weren't going to introduce the Trios titles until Kenny Omega was back. And so maybe Kenny Omega is coming back to team with the Bucks to go after the Trios titles. I don't know what's going on, but something's going on with Hangman texting. So I guess we'll see where this goes. But it will be good to have Kenny Omega back on AEW.
And do you think AEW fans are going to want to boo Kenny Omega when he comes back? I'm not saying that it's impossible to do, because all you got to do is break out Don Callis. And I mean, there are very few people as unlikable on the planet as Don Callis. I mean, in every possible conceivable way, just an awful human being bereft of really any positives whatsoever. But I think you should bring Kenny Omega back as a babyface. And even if the long-term goal is to put him back on the top of the heel side, I think it's going to be really difficult for people to boo him. It's kind of like Jon Moxley. And again, I don't think it's impossible, but I think a reunion with, forget about the Young Bucks, but just Hangman Page and having them kind of try to figure things out as we go along with Adam Cole and the Elite and all that sort of stuff that still needs to be worked out intergroup there. You know, him coming back as a babyface probably would probably be the way I would go.
We also have NXT 2.0 tonight. What a segue that was. We got JD McDonagh versus Cameron Grimes, Josh Briggs, and the Virgin Brooks Jensen. Remember when he had that that Virginity Rocks shirt on?
Yes.
Yeah, I went to the zoo the other day, and I saw someone else with that same sweatshirt. I've now seen it in the wild.
Did you point at him and scream, you know,
no,
Jensen?
I did try to explain this to my wife, and she was like, his gimmick is he's a virgin? I was like, yeah. Anyway, they're facing pretty deadly for the NXT UK tag team titles. Roderick Strong versus Damon Kemp. The in-ring debut. He's never been in the ring in NXT before.
Who?
Axiom, who of course is A-Kid, who has been in the ring. Von Wagner, Solo Sikoa confrontation. The worst name in wrestling, the Schism, will reveal their identities. And here's the women for the Battle Royal. Yulissa Leon, Sloan Jacobs, Lash Legend, Tatum Paxley. I got to wait till after the break. I can't do these names now. I'll do them after the break. These are all real names of people in NXT. Back in a moment. Observer Live. Well, here's the 20 women that will be participating in the NXT Battle Royal tonight, where the winner will get a shot at the Women's Championship held by Mandy Rose. We have got Yulissa Leon, Sloane Jacobs, Lash Led. I can't do it.
No, you have to. You
no,
have
I don't.
To.
You know why I don't yes. have to? You
why?
Know why?
Why?
Because I've got Fauntleroy. He's agreed to read these legitimate, real names in this 20-woman battle royal coming up tonight on NXT. Let's do it, little fellow. The floor is yours.
Yulissa Leon, Sloane Jacobs, Lash Legend, Tatum Paxley, Tiffany Stratton, The Electra Lopez, Ariana Grace, Valentina Faraz, Kiana James, Saray, Wendy Chu, Amari Miller, Fallon Henley, Indy Hartwell, Cora Jade, Alba Fire, Nikita Lyons, Katana Chance, Caden Carter, and Ivy Nile.
His brain short-circuited at one point as he was reading those. Like, he couldn't even get past. Where did he get stuck?
Did he say the Electra
I think he got
Lopez?
Stuck after, yeah, Indy Hartwell.
These names are foreign to Fauntleroy.
Yulissa Leon, Sloane Jacobs.
Sloane Jacobs.
Lash Legend. Tatum Paxley. Tiffany Stratton. Electra Lopez. Ariana Grace.
Who?
Valentina Faraz. Kiana James. Sarai, Wendy Chu, Amari Miller, Fallon Henley, Indy Hartwell, Cora Jade, Alba Fire, also known as Elbow Fire, Nikita Lyons, Katana Chance, Caden Carter, and Ivy Nile.
They brought Sarai back for this, but wouldn't bring over Mako Satomura. Come on.
You want Mako Satomura in this battle royal?
Yes, because I want her just to go in and kick and punch and chop everyone out of the ring with Saray and then just beat up everybody else in the crowd, in the back, the announcers, everybody. Just beat up everybody, tear everything down, and be done with this.
Well, that's not going to happen, Mike.
I know.
But luckily for you, I'll be here tomorrow to review this show. Turns out I'm probably here Thursday as well to review the show. Lucky you. Plans change.
Really?
So
really? What's that about?
Well, we're just not leaving yet, so that's what that's about. We have also got SummerSlam coming up, and we got another week of build for this show. We have got Roman Reigns, Brock Lesnar, Last Man Standing, Liv Morgan, Ronda Rousey for the SmackDown Women's title, Bianca versus Becky for the Raw Women's title, Seth Rollins versus Riddle, Pat McAfee versus Happy Corbin, Bobby Lashley versus Theory for the U.S. title. You guys remember that was for the U.S. title? We talked about this yesterday. Everyone forgot. We've got the Usos versus the Street Profits for the Undisputed WWE Tag Team titles.
How happy are you that Becky is now out of her Barbarella?
She's
superhero.
Not. Did you watch the show? She had another preposterous outfit last night.
That was preposterous.
She's got a new one every week.
It made some sense, at least.
It made sense? What made sense about it, Mike?
That was, compared to what she usually wears, that was downright conservative compared to what she usually has on. I actually thought she looked like a normal human being.
A normal human being. So if I went to the mall, I'd see someone that was wearing what Becky was wearing?
Well,
we don't have malls like that around here.
In the universe of WWE, I'm not talking about going into a mall and picking up something at Hot Topic or something like that. No. Where do you still go to the mall, Bryan? Do you really?
I do all sorts of things, dude.
Do you?
I live a very wild life. SmackDown, 2.077 million viewers on Fox. Down 2% from the previous week. Smallest audience since June 10th. Fourth straight week of viewership decline. Vince is going to need another scandal to help boost them ratings. 0.47 in 18 to 49. Fighter Fest Rampage version, 435,000 viewers, which was up very slightly in viewership, but back down to a 0.14 in 18 to 49. Not good. 11th on cable, which I guess at least it was in the top, I don't know, 11. But still, we talked about this show. Something needs to change. So those are the numbers. What's on you guys' mind? I'm going to save Raw for the next segment.
Which means we got 6 minutes and about 10 seconds to
fill,
folks.
I can fill 6 minutes with anything.
Did you see what I just sent over to you?
Oh, yeah. Why don't you read those?
Okay,
you want me to do
so,
it? I'm not sure you can read. You want me to do it?
Sure. I went to public school. Go ahead.
So did I. Okay. We got bet_online_AG. Was that supposed to be a dot?
I don't know. I believe so. I don't bet online.
Probably a good thing I read it then. So these are the odds for Ric Flair's last match. The match itself, Ric Flair and Andrade are favorites. Minus 2,000. Plus 700 for Jeff Jarrett and Jay Lethal. So, you know, Ric Flair might want to put over a young star on the way out like Jeff Jarrett, so it's possible they could win. But, yeah. Then we've got First to Bleed. And incredibly, Jeff Jarrett is the favorite, is the first to bleed, not Ric Flair. I find that very hard to believe.
Well,
which Ric Flair move will be performed first? The options, and I think this is his entire repertoire, which ironically is also my entire repertoire, chop, elbow drop, leg drop, body slam, figure four, and suplex.
Wait a second, you've never delivered a leg drop?
Oh, yeah, I have. Oh, yeah, I have.
Did you blow out a hip?
No, I did the Bret Hart one where you do the snap leg drop. But anyway, odds are he will do a chop first. Minus 110. So if you think that perhaps he'll open the match with a figure four, you could. That's plus 500. Actually, the question is, when has Ric Flair ever done a leg drop?
I know.
I don't ever remember Ric Flair doing a leg drop in his career.
Well, maybe they mean the rolling knee, because he's always been.
He did the knee drop, which I also stole from him.
Did you pull down the knee pad so it was on the shin before you did it?
Nah. I did that for a while, actually, but I kept hurting my knee. Because when your knee pad's on your shin and you fall on your knee, it hurts your knee. I don't know if you know that or not.
It's physics.
Yeah. Ric Flair's robe color. Here are the options. Gold, red, blue, white, purple, black, pink, and green. For some reason, Ric Flair coming out in a green robe is plus 2,500.
Well.
So I don't know what's going on with this. They think it's more likely he'll come out with a pink robe than a green robe.
I don't know. I like that plus 300 for the Carolina blue thing. So well, maybe I'd go with that.
Gold robe is plus 150.
Yeah. I think it's a good bet.
And then, and this one I actually have a hard time believing. This can't be true. Let me repeat the match for everybody. It is Ric Flair and Andrade versus Jay Lethal and Jeff Jarrett. Okay? Will a guitar be broken in the match? No is the favorite. What? Who wants to make some money with me? You could do a Jeff Jarrett match and no guitars are going to be broken? That's the favorite. That's minus 110. No guitars will be broken. Yes, a guitar will be broken. It's plus 150.
I'm throwing money on that right now.
People are just baffled in the chat.
That's got to be okay. They're seeing what money gets brought in on that one. We could see a changing of that line very quickly.
We have to. Make your money now, everybody. Because that's ridiculous.
I'm surprised the eye poke was not actually on the repertoire of moves here from Ric Flair. Because how can you get to the figure four without at least an eye poke?
You can get to your chop block.
I guess.
Clearly.
You ever see Ric Flair start a match with a chop block? I've seen him start it with an eye poke.
Well, he I've never seen him do a leg drop ever, so I highly doubt he's starting the match with a leg drop.
I wonder if Tommy Young is going to be outside the ring.
Perhaps.
I wonder who the referee is going to be. You really want to show me that WWE
maybe Jeff Jarrett
is okay with this? I want Charles Robinson to be the referee.
Actually, if anybody, it should be Charles Robinson, but I'm not sure they're going to pull that off. Let's see. I was told that Becky Lynch was wearing one of those things that a mom carries their baby in front of them with, but she unstrapped it and took the baby out. So a front pack. Okay. I'd have to look at it again. I have multiple front packs, so I should know one when I see it.
What's your swaddle game like?
I could swaddle. I got a good question here. How would you even start with a leg drop? Does the other guy just lay down?
Yeah. And, well, Jeff Jarrett's got a history of doing that. He's done it at least once or twice, right? So that is completely within the realm of possibility. Now, I would think Ric Flair would drop the knee first, but that's not an option that we're given here as part of this.
Well, I guess it is a tag. So, like, Andrade could slam Jarrett, and then Flair tags in and hits a leg drop.
That's true.
Could do
that's
that.
That's true.
Maybe I should put my money on that leg drop. Nope. Back in a minute with the Raw. Observer Live. Before we get into Raw, I want to make a quick plug here. Jim Valley's got a new shirt, and it's because of you fans. You can check it out, f4wonline.com/shirts. Do you know we have a lot of cool shirts? We got the most popular shirt of all time, which just happens to be my shirt. Which one was that again? I already forgot.
Chop and Roll?
Nah, it was...
Minus 5 stars?
Minus 5 stars, that's right.
Yeah.
We'll see if Jim can beat minus 5 stars. Hey, if you want a minus 5-star shirt or an Observer shirt, F4W, Vinny shirt, or Jim Valley's, F4WOnline.com/shirts. We're even thinking of producer Dom getting a shirt.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Put it next to Granny's?
Yeah, Granny's does well, too, I heard.
Uh-huh.
All right.
What's a producer Dom shirt going to say? What's the tagline for that? Bryan, I've hit the dumb button because you've cursed again.
It'll
I don't know if that's going to fit on a shirt,
best
Bryan.
Best producer ever. Dom. It'll be a say, Dom in the airwaves.
Actually,
with producer
make sure,
Dom.
Make sure that shirt comes to fruition here, and then we'll send a ton of them over to Rob.
Oh, you're you're such a horrible person sometimes. So the show opened up. Hey, did you hear about Titus O'Neil?
Oh, my God.
Yeah, I love Titus O'Neil, but man, this poor guy had to come out and talk about WWE and how they needed goodwill more than ever now.
It
was their
space.
Job to put smiles on faces. They'd never talk about politics or religion, except when there's an important angle that involves politics or religion. Remember when God wrestled? Maybe it was a different, maybe it was a non-religious God I was unaware of. But anyway, he welcomed everybody to Raw. And that was quite the segment. Then we had Becky coming down to the ring. You know what's so funny about this? I don't even care. Remember they had that poll, it's like, who has better storytelling, WWE or AEW? Well, the story is that Becky lost 100 matches in a row, okay? And she was just done at the bottom of the barrel. She won one match, and now she's headlining SummerSlam against the winner of Bianca and Carmella. So anyway, they have the match. There was an argument and everything beforehand, but it wasn't all that exciting. So they have the match. They go 10 minutes. It's not very good. And then finally, Carmella slaps Bianca, and Bianca's like, oh, yeah? And she gets mad, grabs her, hits her move, and pins her. It's like, well, what did we waste 10 minutes for if it was that easy? All you had to do was get mad and hit your move. So she did, and now it is Bianca versus Becky coming up at SummerSlam. We had Angelo Dawkins and Street Profits, Montez, all excited about Jeff Jarrett. And MVP and Omos show up. MVP makes fun of Dawkins for losing to Omos last week, and he wants him to do a singles match later on tonight, which unfortunately was accepted. We had the KO show, and this is more great storytelling. So Kevin Owens is out there. He introduces a riddle. He says, you're a laid-back sort of fella. And he goes, you know, you lost your best friend, Randy, and I lost my best friend, Seth Rollins. He said horrible things about me. For those of you who forget, Seth called him fat. He actually, there was another part of it, but and Kevin got very upset about that. They're not friends anymore. So Kevin said, you know what would be cool is you lost your friend, I lost mine. Why don't we team up together? Bro KO for Kevin Owens. Bro KO. And Matt Riddle says, listen, I don't trust you. And so Kevin Owens says, rightly, dude, you teamed up with Randy Orton. Nobody in the history of WWE has turned on, which is a lie, by the way, because it's a big show, but no one has turned on more people. No one is less trustworthy than Randy Orton. Now, this is a true statement, okay? He's had 20 years of screwing people over. But this makes Riddle angry. And so Riddle gets really mad, and then Seth flies in and blindsides him and gives him a stump. So I don't know if Owens and Seth are friends again. That was not made clear because Kevin Owens just vanished. But that's going to lead to SummerSlam.
Well,
and then,
Bryan, that is subjective. That is subjective. If you are Matt Riddle, you are saying to yourself, no, Randy has not turned on me, Kevin Owens. Meanwhile, you are sitting here begging for a friend. I've got a friend, and his name is Randy. So that is not true that Kevin Owens is less trustworthy or more trustworthy than Randy Orton is.
We're talking about history, dude. In the history of this business, Randy Orton has turned on more people than Kevin Owens because he's been around for 20 years. He's had more people to turn on. It's math. So then Rollins is getting interviewed, and Ezekiel is angry at him for beating up Riddle. So Ezekiel shows up. They argue back and forth. This also leads to a match. Judgment Day, they vow that Dominic will join Judgment Day tonight. This leads to Damian Priest versus Rey Mysterio. 1 week before Rey's 20th anniversary celebration on Raw, he goes in there, a five-minute match, he gets beat clean in the middle. So then they start beating him up afterwards. They're going to give him the concerto. They say, Dominic, if you don't get in here, if you don't join the Judgment Day right now, we're gonna take out your dad. So Dominic agrees to join. But then, after he agrees to join, they say, it don't work like that. And they start beating him up. And then they go to give the concerto, but Rey flees. So they're teasing that next week, it's Rey and Dominic versus Judgment Day. And Judgment Day says they're going to finish off the Mysterios once and for all. Which, when
Everybody,
you think about it, you know where this is going. Dominic
Everybody
is joining,
this.
And thus they will finish off the Mysterios once and for all.
They're all chumps. Everybody involved in this is a chump. And yeah, that's the direction I guess that they're going ahead with. But like, Dominic's a chump, Rey's a chump, Damian Priest, who just self-destructed after having the, Intercontinental title for how long without being beat, he's a chump. Finn Balor lost himself into this position by being embarrassed and flopping around like a fish and then falling off the ropes and then losing to Edge. And then all of a sudden now he replaces Edge. And come on, the only good, smart person in any of this right now is what's her name? Because she's out and hurt and whatever it is, getting her face fixed.
Rhea.
Rhea Ripley. That's the only person that's benefiting from any of this right now because she's not there. Is Damian Priest any better off than where he was before? And Damian Priest, a guy who's got years on him, a guy who looks good in a suit and is tall and had everything going for him, now this is where you're at because this is going to make him a better WWE superstar. Come on.
Bro, he could be in Maximum Male Models. So I would say he's doing just fine right now with Finn Balor. And next week with Young Dom. Then the Rated R Superstar can return. Team with Rey Mysterio. You got tag matches. There's a lot worse things that could happen.
He could be in Maximum Male Models.
Yeah. He could be. He's doing better now than if he were doing the Summer Collection this coming Friday. Trust me. Seth Rollins face Ezekiel. It honestly wasn't all that good. It was all right. Curb stomp finish was not the worst thing on the show because that was coming up later. We have a bunch of other stuff. Angelo Dawkins and Omos. They have a horrible match. It goes a minute 20. And then Montez Ford tried to trip Omos. Then MVP tripped Dawkins. And the ref saw him and called for the disqualification. So Dawkins beats Omos via DQ. The fans groaned, loud groans, like, my God. So then Adam Pearce comes out. And you know what he says? He goes, I think the fans here want to see the Street Profits versus MVP and Omos. I don't think he was right, but that's what he said. Then he goes, don't say we don't give you what you want. And he signs the match. I was like, wow, that was quite the line. Don't say we don't give you what you want. We're going to give you this match. So they give us this match, the Street Profits versus Omos and MVP in a full three-piece suit. You'll never guess the finish. Montez Ford, who is challenging for the World Tag Team titles at SummerSlam, hits the biggest frog splash you've ever seen on Omos, and Omos kicks out at one. So we have to do the close-up of Ford for about 5 minutes, showing his shocked face. And then finally, he decides to go up and try again. Because if at first you don't succeed, he goes up top and he gets attacked by the Usos for the DQ. So they did a DQ to set up a second match that went to a DQ. So then, hey guys, like this theory? Well, if you do, have I got the show for you? Theory comes out, and he talks, and he talks, and he talks, and he talks, and he talks. And the fans go, what? 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 So he got heat, but it's a bunch of what chants. So this brings out AJ. He makes fun of AJ for being old. And, of course, he's young. And this leads to a match. And, you know, listen. Bro, this guy, dude. They want this guy to be their next John Cena, okay? Fine. You're pushing him to the moon. You're giving him a lot of talking time. But, brother, when he gets in that ring, he's got to be able to do something. You know one of the reasons that fans turned on John Cena when he got that spot in 2005. You want to know one of the reasons they turned on that guy? Well, they turned on him because you had the SmackDown 6 and your Jerichos and your Eddies and your Benoits and all these great workers, and they pushed John Cena to the top, who wasn't a very good worker. Well, bro, this theory goes in there. It has the most boring match. He had the most boring match on Friday with Madcap Moss, who's a great athlete. And he had an equally boring match here with AJ. You know how hard it is to have a boring match with AJ Styles? Dude, he gets the heat and he puts him in a chin lock. And it's a chin lock. And it's a chin lock. And AJ escapes and he puts him back in a chin lock. And a chin lock. AJ escapes. He takes him down, puts him in an arm bar. And he holds the arm bar. I'm like, dude. Yeah, this worked great for Baron Corbin when he was going in there having boring matches every week because he thought it was a great way to get heat. Well, now, you know, it turned out fans decided he was boring and then he wasn't a main eventer anymore. So, dude, you gotta let this guy do some stuff. These matches are killing me. And then they go to a count out. A count out! After Ziggler super kicks him outside. I'm losing it. Asuka, Alexa, and Dana versus Tamina, Doudrop, and Nikki Ash. Dave argued this. Maybe he's right, but I don't believe it. They said that the 24-7 rule is waived when the champions are having a match. Well, 24-7 champions in the match. Tozawa runs in. Tozawa pins Dana. Nikki pins Tozawa. Bliss pins Nikki. Doudrop pins Bliss. Tamina pins Doudrop. Brooke pins Tamina. Brooke then runs away from a six-man. And then Asuka gets the win. 2 minutes and 35 seconds for seven title changes. Then we finally have the main event. Miz TV with Logan Paul. You guys like Logan Paul? Well, no one else does. He's booed unmercifully. They boo him. They cheer the Miz. He's trying so hard to be a babyface. He fails the entire time. Finally, he gets his one line in that Miz has tiny balls. He gets a tiny balls chant. Miz ends up attacking him. He beats him up. Ciampa tries to attack him. He clears the ring of both guys, bails. Still can't get cheered. Back in a moment, Observer Live. You know, maybe I'm misremembering, but I seem to recall, I know for sure, NXT taped 3 weeks of shows, and those shows were like way better than usual. And then when they went live again, we started to have a bunch of bad matches and everything was botched. So it was like clear that the taped was the reason. Am I wrong that like Raw and SmackDown, you know, Raw is still way too long? But I seem to think that like a month or so ago, these shows were fine. Like, I'm not going to say they were great shows, but they were fine. And man, like this past week and I think last week as well, is this because of Vince's stress over all this stuff that's going on? Is this why these shows are like this? Because they seem to have fallen off the rails over the last week, week and a half, 2 weeks or so. Am I wrong about that?
Yeah, but hasn't there been a lot more talking and a lot less wrestling in that time, too?
Well, yeah, they've changed something.
Yeah, we were getting that run of longer matches, but they've jerked back and forth with that philosophy. And when you go with more talking and you have less stars and you have more filler and you have more of the same over and over again, I mean, what else are you going to get out of it except for what we're getting on Raw and on SmackDown?
Listen, I know people here are laughing when I said Vince being stressed, but bro, listen, the guy doesn't sell anything, but don't think that he's not stressed out about this thing because this is a potentially really big deal. So he ain't going to show it, and he's going to act like a crazy person. He's going to go out there and scream. I can't even say the profanity scream when he went through the position after he did those interviews out there after this all went down. But he's sweating, but he won't let you see him sweat like that old commercial, that old deodorant commercial. Yeah, it is business as usual, but he's sweating. He ain't going to sell it, though. That's the point. Anyway. We're out of time. Raw did me in. Good thing I waited till the last segment. I'll be back later today with Lance. Check my Twitter to find out when. May have to change the timing, but that's coming up a little bit later on today. Bryan and Vinny Show tonight with Granny and Craig. And we'll talk to you next time, Wrestling Observer Live.